No.
Thank you.
made known by the message of an angel, made by his passion and cross, he brought to the glory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you.
Mary set out and went as quickly as she could to a town in the hill country of Judah. She went into Zechariah's house and greeted Elizabeth. Now, as soon as Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. She gave a loud cry and said, "Of all women, you are the most blessed, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Why should I be honored with a visit from the mother of my Lord? For the moment your greeting reached my ears, the child in my womb leapt for joy. Yes, blessed is she who believed that the promise made her by the Lord would be fulfilled." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Firstly, an apology. I got into an awful muddle this week with the sheet that we normally give out at the back, and I printed both the bidding prayers, and then I went and printed the Sunday plus leaflets. And normally, of course, one is on the back of the other, so that made things a bit difficult. So this means that the homily is on the back of the bidding prayers this week. But please do take it up anyway. Or you could say the winning prayers on the back of the homily, it doesn't matter. They are together, and on the back of the Sunday plus leaflet is the notice about Christmas services. So do take one of those so that you've got those as well. It was Monday morning, and I got an early morning phone call, and I don't like early morning phone calls because very rarely are they good news. But the caller ID said it was my friend Bob Ford in Wales, and so I was even more worried because he had a heart attack back in May, and I thought this was even worse bad news. But in fact, he was ringing me to tell me that his niece had just had a baby. So really lovely, good news, and he just couldn't wait to share it with all his friends, regardless of how early in the morning it was. And there's something about news, both good and bad. The most watched programs on the TV apparently are the news programs. And even though it can be very repetitious and depressing, people want to keep up with the latest news. And if we have news of our own, we want to share it. You have to tell someone, news just begs to be passed on. But how terrible it is if the news that we have to share is bad news. My mother has been diagnosed with cancer. I've just had a call and Sally's gone missing. Unfortunately, Robert has been made redundant. Our heart sinks when people, our friends, share news like that with us. But then we get the opposite sort, when it's different and so good. John's done well, he got the grades he wanted. Caroline's just got engaged. And the news, like the news that Father Paul gave to me. Perhaps there's nothing quite like that joy of telling someone that a baby has been born. Is it a girl or a boy? Is our first question. And then, are the mother and baby doing well? How much does the baby weigh? All these questions we ask. And as we hear in today's gospel, Mary was bursting with news, and it was about the birth of her baby. She couldn't keep it to herself. And no sooner did the angel bring her the good news of great joy, she was going to bear a child, then she had to go and share it with her cousin Elizabeth. And the news tumbled out of her, and immediately Elizabeth was beside herself with joy, because she too had her own good news. She'd given up all hope of having a baby, and then suddenly she had similar news to share. Perhaps we could ask why she hadn't gone the other way, since her news came earlier. Why hadn't she gone to see Mary and tell her that she was pregnant? But probably because she was so much older, it wouldn't be good for her to travel over those rough roads. And we know Mary was very young, fit. So it was that these women shared their good news. And just at that moment, Elizabeth's child stirred inside her, leapt in her womb, as the gospel put it, and they were filled with joy. And something more. Elizabeth wasn't only filled with joy, she was filled with the Holy Spirit. And it was filled with the Holy Spirit that she made the exclamation that she did and gave us, if ever we should need it, the reason for our exaltation of Mary. He cried out to her cousin, "Of all women, you are the most blessed, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Why should I be honored with a visit from the mother of my Lord?" And suddenly, her young cousin had become the mother of my Lord. And the visit of Mary was an honor. And then Elizabeth added, "Blessed is she who believed that the promise made her by the Lord would be fulfilled." It's exactly what Michael the prophet had promised in today's reading. The Savior will be born in Bethlehem. He himself will be peace. Mary believed the promise would be fulfilled and would be fulfilled in her. That's the real secret of Mary, her faith, that she believed that what God promised her would truly happen. And the two women joyfully share their faith together. Mary, traveling with the good news of the gospel, was the first apostle, in fact, the first evangelist, the first missionary, the first person to share the faith that she had. And when she reached Elizabeth, there was a stirring in response. We hear an awful lot today about spreading the faith. Current phrase is the new evangelization. Pope Francis commented on it, "We evangelize not only with grand words or complicated concepts, but with the joy of the gospel." He wrote a whole epistle about it. And the ones who do this best are often those whom the world has treated badly, or those who've made a mess of their life and who find their way to the church where Jesus meets us and answers the prayer we made in the response to today's psalm, "Let your face shine on us and we shall be saved." That's how the church began, how the gospel was first preached, how it spread throughout the world. People couldn't keep it to themselves. Good news has to be shared, even if it is at 7 o'clock in the morning. There are lots of ways to do it. Singing carols around the streets, collecting for good causes, sending Christmas cards, perhaps using pictures of the nativity rather than snowmen and reindeers and robins, having nativity plays, inviting somebody to come with us to a mass over Christmas. Through simple ways, people can come to recognize that what we are celebrating is the birth of Jesus, the Savior of the world, and the faith of his mother, Mary. Stand and say together our statement of faith and truth, as when we're using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from death. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
May we as a society help them see God's love in the help we give them. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Today we pray for all expectant mothers. May they be especially blessed during their weeks of waiting and be rewarded with the joy of new life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for the children of our time. May they know love and affection, care and attention from those charged with their care. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for those who mourn the loss of someone special at this time, that they may experience the warmth, comfort, and support of others. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
As the Advent season draws to a close, we remember the real meaning of Christmas and ask God that the birth of his Son will bring peace on earth to all. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We join our prayers with Mary, the mother of Jesus. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In a moment of silence, we bring our personal prayers to God.
Hear our prayers, O Heavenly Father, who sent your Son Jesus Christ to bring your message of salvation to the world. We offer these prayers in your name, O loving and generous God. Amen. the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary, through Christ our Lord. Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Mystery of faith.
And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by which death you will, to reconcile us to yourself. Brothers, we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your election, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed Joseph, as well, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope and Mark, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family who have summoned before you. In your compassion and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Have the pages of our own former divine teaching we hear today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
For Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes
and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Would you please sit? There is a page at the back. I explained that the homily and the prayers are now on the same sheet. There's also a sheet with Christmas services and the Sunday class on the back. You'll also find a copy of this newsletter from the Evangelization and Catechesis group. If you would like one of those, please take a copy of that. We've also been sent some diaries. These are out on the table. There aren't very many of them, but if you would like one of the little diaries for the parish, they are on the table as well. I know somebody was asking about them this week. I can't remember who it was, but they have come. Tomorrow there is an online mass at 9 o'clock, and then church cleaning fees for all those who are fit and able to be here at 10:30. We do want the church to be really lovely for all those who will be visiting us over the Christmas period. So if you can spare half an hour to help with the cleaning tomorrow, 10:30, please be here. Anything else? I know Jane wants to say a few words. Anything else up the top? There is a closing second collection today for flowers. Peter will be at the door with it for that.
Thank you, Father Paul. Thank Father Paul especially for all his support and encouragement during this synodal journey, which this is the last week that our diocese has asked us to consider the final topic. Before I mention that, just two other points. May we have your footprints, please. Both feet moving towards the altar, towards Christ, which is what our journey is all about. So if you have them any time in the next 2 years, I would be very grateful if we could put them around church, just to remind us that the journey continues. It continues for all of us. It moves on to the bishops of England and Wales. It moves to Europe, and then to the universal church, and finally to Rome. The Giving Tree ends today. If anyone is out shopping and considers our gifts for our local community, please leave them under the tree. Chris O'Brien has been wonderful about gathering our gifts and our food bank offerings every Monday. He does that quietly and unassumedly. Every Monday he creeps into church and he gathers our gifts to be given to our local people. I spoke to someone from Mustard Seed this week, and he said Kathy had brilliantly given lots of things that, from our coffee morning donations towards buying Christmas treats. He said thank you very, very much for all that we do, but they've had to find 100 more food bank baskets for our local community. The 100 more people have asked for support. So there is much need in our affluent, beautiful Cornish area. So if you can, would you consider that when you're shopping this week? Finally, our journey. Let us dream. Our Holy Father has asked us to dream. What would we like our church to be for the generations to follow? Using Father John Belowski's lovely words on the front of Evangelium, what a privilege, therefore, each of us is being offered through the Synod, get alongside and listen to each and any person we meet, especially those on the outside of our church circles. The conversations that may arise could be a vital and life-giving experience for all concerned, for our church. With that in mind, the diocese has offered us the possibility at this time when we welcome friends into our homes, we welcome family who might not be associated with the Catholic Church, but with us, the Church, and Christ reaching out to others. They have given us some pointers about how to talk and listen actively, how to present these questions, and then there is a very short form. If anyone has an offering to be passed on for the synodal journey, then it's just a small sheet there asking for you to share your thoughts. Those short thoughts are valid and they are to be respected without any judgment and with no names. If you would prefer not to hand them in to me or to Mary Keeley or to just leave them here at church, then you can do all of that online using the diocesan website and looking for the synodal journey. If you have had any thoughts in the last 4 weeks on listening, how do we listen to church, and how does the church listen to us, to our role in mission? This is mission. This is reaching out. To last week's celebrate, how would you like the church to continue to celebrate the presence of Christ in our world? And finally, dream. Let us dream.
We will end Mass today with the solemn blessing for Ash. Would you please stand? The Lord be with you. By your head, the Lord's blessing. May the Almighty and Merciful God, by whose grace you have placed your faith in the first coming of his only begotten Son, and yearn for his coming again, sanctify you by the radiance of Christ's advent, and enrich you with his blessing. As you run the race of this present life, may he make you firm in faith, joyful in hope, and active in charity.
Amen.
So that rejoicing now with devotion at the Redeemer's coming in the flesh, you may be endowed